Aber dann, ja, nekoborim dobro po vašom jezikom, musim govorit po anglicky, ali pitanje može biti po vašom jezikom. And now, unfortunately, I will continue in English, and I will be a bit less abstract than the last debate. And I think when we talk about alternatives, that was the task that Center za politike emancipacije put to me, I think we have to start with what is now. And in the morning it was already mentioned that there's more discussion about the European periphery in the south rather than the European peripheries in the east. And the two peripheries, I would say there are at least two peripheries in the east, at least two, possibly even three, but two of them I will focus on. One is what is usually called Central Eastern Europe, and the other Southeastern Europe. And I would like to start with the Visegrad countries, but as well with Slovenia, because Slovenia has more features in common economically with the Visegrad countries than with the other successor states to Yugoslavia. And regarding Southeastern Europe, I will focus only on the post-Yugoslav space. I mean, that is the region you are most familiar with. And I will draw on two theories, theory of regulation and the dependency approach. And I think the dependency approach is insofar very important as the peripheries are integrated into the international and into the European economy in an asymmetrical and in a dependent way. And since the early 1990s, but even more so since the beginning of the negotiation process with the European Union in the late 1990s, the dependence on foreign capital has been a central feature of both sub-peripheries I mentioned. And in the Central East European countries and to a lesser extent in Slovenia, that has been more restrictive regarding foreign capital. Foreign capital flowed both into export industrialization and into the financial sector. And both in the Visegrad countries and in Slovenia, the pre-crisis development model, let's say lasting from the late 1990s, to 2008 actually was based on two pillars. One pillar was industrial export production. And this industrial export production has been mainly controlled by foreign capital, with the partial exception of Slovenia. And it has been mainly the outsourcing of certain parts of production, not of the complete chain of production, but only of certain elements of it. And it has not been based on own technological research. Research and development expenditure has been fairly low. For example, in Poland and in Slovakia, even less than 1% of the gross domestic product, that is totally negligible. So far, this industrial export production has relied on foreign technology. It has relied as well on low wages, relatively low wages, comparing the wages, let's say, with Germany and Austria, that is two of the neighboring countries, difference is 1 to 3 to 1 to 4. I mean, that's quite significant. The wage share is significantly lower than in Germany or in Austria, at least 10 to 15% percentage points. I mean, that is quite significant. And this industrial production usually has been concentrated in a few areas. For example, in Slovakia, almost all the export industrial production is in the west of the country and hardly anything in the east and in the center of the country, for example. Poland, likewise, certain parts of the west of the country, Hungary, again, the west of the country. Always, we can summarize it with the west of the country. No? And in the other areas, unemployment often is very high. Even, for example, in the east of Slovakia, it is at times more than 20%, and in Bratislava, it is 4 to 5%. I mean, there is an enormous, enormous difference. And an enormous difference in the living standards, too. And the national production is not nationally integrated. It is regionally integrated in a subordinate position. But at least this industrial production has produced exports, and exports at least at times even outstripped imports, or at least they helped to contain the current account deficit in most years. At least immediately before the crisis, it was usually about 5% of the GDP. The second pillar of the model relied on financialization, and then the specific type of financialization, that is credits provided to private households. And consumption and housing, particularly housing, have relied heavily on credits. And so far, in spite of low wages, consumption was increasing to some extent because private indebtedness increased. But that is obviously not a permanent solution. And in some countries, but not in all of the countries, this credit expansion was built on foreign capital inflows. In particular in Slovenia, where some of the credits also went to the company sector, and even more so in the case of Hungary. And Hungary was the only of these five countries where the banks provided the credits mainly in the form of foreign exchange credits, Swiss franc credits and euro credits. I mean, this is a familiar story for Serbia as well. Whereas in Poland, the central bank, I mean, put a brake on that. They were, I mean, behaving differently from the Hungarian central bank. And in the Czech Republic and Slovakia, the banks relied on the deposits of the customers, and they provided the credits in domestic currency. And that is really an advantage. And I mean, the crisis, the global crisis of 2008-2009, laid bare some of the weaknesses of the models, because I mean, the exports at the end of 2008, beginning of 2009, declined heavily. And in the smaller countries, the exports are concentrated in a few branches, especially the car industry. And the decline of the car industry had serious effects on Slovakia, Czech Republic, Slovenia, and Hungary. Less so on Poland, because the economy is more diversified. And in the case of Hungary and of Slovenia, not only the decline in exports, but also the problems of refinancing the expanding credit expansion became a very serious problem. And I mean, a financial crisis emerged in the case of Hungary because of the high degree of foreign exchange credits. The forint, Hungarian currency, depreciated massively at the end of 2008. And with that, the foreign exchange indebted middle class debtors got into serious trouble because, I mean, repaying the credits, paying interest rates became much more expensive. And with that, the banking sector went into crisis as well. And actually, it was not Greece, but Hungary. Hungary was the first EU country to get a credit, demand a credit, and to get a credit from the International Monetary Fund, and to get funding from the EU as well. But as in the case with Greece, austerity as a condition. And in Slovenia, austerity policies were applied as well, but they have been of a homegrown character, but not very different from the Hungarian case. And what have been the consequences of the crisis? I would say, in the case of Hungary, the victory of the Fidesz, of the National Conservative Party, has been a consequence of the crisis. And whereas the social liberal government did not deal with the foreign exchange debt issue, Fidesz did so because they converted the credits at a more advantageous exchange rate to forint, thus helping their indebted middle classes, and that is their social base. Mm-hmm. Secondly, not only in Hungary, but in the other countries as well, the debate on the role of foreign capital has become more critical, partially from the right, case of Fidesz. And Fidesz is increasing the role of domestic capital, but only in the service sector, not in the industrial sector, not at all. That is very important, because in the industrial sector, they leave everything as it is, but in the banking sector, big commerce, they are squeezing a bit the foreign capital and increasing spaces in these relatively protected sectors for domestic capital. But in the Czech Republic, for example, the left has said it cannot, some left wing of the Czech social democracy, that the FDI-based model cannot continue as it is because there will be no more FDI. And secondly, that there is a huge drain of profit remittances. In the case of Czech Republic, 6 to 7% of GDP, same in Hungary. And there is an incipient debate of the profile of industrial production as well. That is still very incipient. But that this very narrow specialization has turned out to be very problematic. And in so far, maybe diversifying production would not be such a bad idea. Especially on the left, but some conservative circles say that as well. And in Poland, the peace government, Prawo i Sprawiedliwość government, I mean the economy minister of economic affairs has said we need industrial policy, we need structural policy. Free trade approach should not be continued because it is partially dysfunctional. He even came out in favor of trade unions, what Fidesz would never say. So that is Central Eastern Europe. Very brief resume. In the case of Southeastern Europe, especially of the successor states to Yugoslavia, the industrial production was massively affected both by the disintegration process of Yugoslavia and of course because of war as well, particularly in Bosnia-Herzegovina, but as well in Serbia and Montenegro, I mean, there was not too much as well. And Industrial production never really recovered, only very partially recovered. In Serbia, it is, the maximum was about 50% of the 1989 level, and very low. Case of Croatia, about 80%, but I mean 80% is still 20% less, and now it is less than that 80%. So far, there is no second pillar. There was no second pillar for the growth model of the pre-crisis years. Pre-crisis growth in countries like Croatia, Bosnia-Herzegovina, Serbia, Montenegro, Macedonia was mainly based on credit growth. And that credit growth relied very heavily on capital inflows. So far it was a very dependent form of financialization. And these credits have been primarily in the form of foreign exchange credits. I mean, Montenegro went even a step further and introduced unilaterally first the Deutschmark and then the Euro. Same was done by the International Administration of Kosovo. And with this reliance on foreign capital inflows and the accompanying very rigid exchange rate policies and the very weak industrial structures, the current account deficit in the successor states of Yugoslavia, with the exception of Slovenia, was between very high and astronomical. In the case of Croatia, about 10%, in the case of Montenegro, at times beyond 30% of the GDP. I mean, that is almost not imaginable. And with that, all these countries have been very heavily affected by the crisis, and 2008-2009 recession was considerable. In some cases, the recession was very long-lasting, like in the case of Croatia. All these countries adopted very orthodox economic so-called anti-crisis policies, and these anti-crisis policies reduced the current account deficit, but increased the problems on the debt side. Obviously, debt remains the same or increased, and the GDP declined. I mean, the burden increases. And I mean, high unemployment became even higher. And whereas in countries like Poland or Slovakia or the Czech Republic, there was some economic recovery, I mean, in the successor states to Yugoslavia, I mean, there was not really much of a recovery. I would say it was permanent stagnation. And the restructuring issue is much more, I would say it's much more, in some respects, much more difficult and even more urgent. So that would be my first part. And I will continue with the question of the alternatives a bit later. And now, maybe questions, comments on the present situation before coming to the more difficult part of the alternatives. So that would be one of my starting points. Very difficult to achieve. That's quite obvious. And even more difficult today than it was 40 years ago. Because penetration of foreign capital, subordinate integration into production chains, much more advanced than it used to be. Second question is the question of the monetary order. If you have adopted a common currency, it is a very serious problem for the peripheral regions. And, I mean, inside the European Union, the was done on a multilateral basis. In the case of Montenegro and Kosovo, that was done unilaterally. So, I mean, that is even more more complicated. Countries like Serbia or Croatia have a national currency, but the debts
in foreign currency are very substantial, particularly the private debts. And with that, depreciating the currency is very difficult because all the debtors in foreign exchange have a very serious problem. And in the case of the Swiss franc credits, because, I mean, the Swiss franc appreciated for many years, already have become a publicly debated issue, and in Croatia they even have taken very small steps in addressing the problem because it could not be avoided anymore. From my point of view, it would be necessary to convert the foreign exchange credits into national currency in order to have more spaces for domestic exchange rate policies and potentially some date as well for monetary policies. I mean, that applies, but for those countries where these foreign exchange credits play a very significant role. I mean, that is the case for Serbia, the case for Croatia, for example. I think that certain forms of a more indirect protection do exist as well. For example, you have public tenders, and you could put certain clauses in the public tenders that would give a certain advantage for certain qualitative criteria to certain groups. For example, that it has to be ecological, case of agricultural products, that they are fresh, so then they can't come from very distant regions, that those who take a contract have to adhere to a collective agreement, for example, things like that. And one should see to what extent that is possible. But I mean, in how far the state, given the real existing conditions, would be able, administratively able and politically able to translate that into a sensitive policy, I would say it's very demanding thing. It's almost a bit like dreaming, maybe. But at least it indicates a direction that is at least possible, though not without problems. And I think that such forms of helping local production would be useful. I think that the regional policy that directly intervenes into production is a necessity. And whereas usually industrial policy is geared towards exports, and it is usually the only topic that is talked about that is production for exporting, I think that it would be useful to have more import substituting production geared towards the local market or the national market, and that more integrated forms of micro-regional production and consumption would be useful, and would be useful as well for ecological reasons, because shorter transport routes obviously would be a good thing from an ecological point of view. And I don't see that without forms of socialized production that might be partially state production, that might be partially other forms of socialized production, but I would not exclude, at least for the beginning, private, small and medium scale production as well. So I would not like to see tycoon-y type of of production. So in a way, a selective approach, but the possibilities for that are much more reduced inside the EU than outside, obviously, because of the regulations on competition. In the case of Serbia, for example, it's a question of what could be done about the still existing state-owned but totally neglected production, whether it would not be thinkable at least to have in some cases something like a conscious rehabilitation of production, special facilities of the state for rehabilitating, reconstructing existing production instead of subsidizing foreign-owned business. Yeah? For example, in Smederevo or wheresoever. Yeah? So far, a refocusing of subsidizing and changing the logics of production. All these steps take a very long time to take root, and that is one of the problems, and one of the very serious problems. And in the beginning, usually they need foreign exchange for buying machinery, because local machinery production is usually very weak. And without reducing the current account deficit and the structurally deeply ingrained tendency towards the current account deficit, the policy spaces are very, very low. And I mean, a historical problem of Yugoslavia since 1945 has been the permanent current account deficit of the region. And it, from my point of view, that is one of the problems to be addressed. And without addressing that, I mean, there is a vulnerability to external pressure. And Yugoslavia was suffering from that vulnerability that should not be forgotten. And that Yugoslavia in the 1980s had a severe financial crisis and it had a severe current account deficit as well. And so far that history has repeated itself a couple of times. And I think it is essential to address the problem. And the left has been much better in discussing things like a different fiscal policy, and I think a different fiscal policy is necessary. You need more state funding, you need a different type of tax structure, more direct taxation, higher direct taxes, higher corporate taxes instead of higher value-added taxes, things like that, that's important, but it does not suffice on its own. And I mean, Marx coined the term relations of production, and that he emphasized production had good reasons for that. And I think the left has, unfortunately, to address the thorny question of production. And that, with that, we can open the discussion. Thank you very much.